Star Trek, the next generation. You love throughout the nation. You're my favorite show. Was in every episode, you're lucky. You don't have to wait for buses. You just step into the transporter and off you boldly go. Mr. Wolf's my favorite person.
We are the Org. Our mission is to assimilate Star Trek The Next Generation, Star Trek Deep Space Nine, and beer. Lots of beer.
Hello!
Hello!
And welcome to bOrgCast 6.5, take 2.
Yeah.
Oh!
Whoops.
Some idiot forgot to check which microphone was plugged in. So we recorded an entire podcast sitting on the opposite side of the room, talking into a microphone that wasn't plugged in.
Yeah.
Yay! The downsides to this are that you'll get potentially a less ranty Anne-Marie because she got very ranty over schisms.
Yeah.
Also, we now know, because of course we listen to the feedback, as we always do as we're recording, so we now know that we are very much in a minority when it comes to schisms.
Yeah.
In our general not liking it very much and Anne-Marie absolutely hating it. On the upside, we'll be able to cover Q-Less without Anne-Marie sort of falling asleep, getting the hiccups, and generally not saying very much because she's trying not for her hiccups to show up on the recording.
Yeah, I rage drank.
Oh, yes.
3 pints of strong cider after schisms and then had the hiccups.
Yeah.
And they were quite loud hiccups, so I just sort of sat away from the microphone, hiccuping quietly in the corner for the vast majority of the Deep Space Nine episode.
So this is going to be kind of a curious experience for us because we've never done things this way around before. We've never done a re-recording either. But there we go. Needs must when the devil farts in your face, as the saying goes. So
does it?
Well, it does now.
Right.
Let's have some news.
Okay.
We announced in bOrgCast 6.4 that we've been nominated for a Parsec Award, and it's since been announced that the Babylon Project has been as well.
Hooray! Huzzah!
So congratulations to Matt and JJ.
Congratulations!
Given the fact that I had my day off set aside for editing the podcast that never was, I instead spent the day sorting out our 10 minutes of clipped send-offs. Many thanks to those who suggested ideas, and particular thanks to Fatbone Smith for helpfully narrowing down the choices for me by putting together basically what was pretty much an hour and a half's worth of our best material. So thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Much appreciated. And I think we ended up with 10 vaguely presentable minutes, but I've put what we've included up on the Geek Planet Online forums if you're interested. We've had some general feedback. Wayne Peters confirmed that there is indeed a set of spin-off novels featuring Scotty, post-Relics, if you remember.
Yeah, we did wonder, didn't we?
Him going off on a shuttle. Well, yes, that explains what happened next. It's part of the Starfleet Corps of Engineers series of books, which also features Sonia Gomez.
Hot chocolate woman.
Hot chocolate woman. She of all of two appearances in Next Generation, so clearly she was really worth fleshing out, wasn't she? Hmm. And Wayne didn't seem very impressed by the books, so I don't feel like I'm missing out there, definitely. And hello to Richard Patterson, who was asking after the music we used at the end of the last bOrgCast. It was the Ribbon Ooze from their 1998 album Paleophonic.
Right.
Yeah, and very cool it was too.
It was, but I've never heard of the Ribbon Ooze.
Cool music to not-so-cool schisms.
Yeah.
Without warning and no explanation, an experiment in terror has begun.
I've been in this room before.
We've all been here before.
Have crew members been kidnapped and memories erased?
I need to know if anyone comes on or off this ship.
It looks as though your arm has been severed and then reattached.
And will they be sacrificed as human guinea pigs?
Commander Riker has been taken from the Enterprise.
Next time on Star Trek The Next Generation.
So we start with the trailer.
Yes.
The trailer, which gives away the twist.
Yeah.
Apparently these things were shown like at the end of one episode to make you want to watch the next one.
It doesn't work.
Yes. I mean, what little value there is in watching this episode, if you've seen that trailer, is none at all.
No.
Are they conducting experiments? Well, if they are, you've just given the entire plot away, you prat.
Yeah.
My life.
Yeah. So you could just watch the trailer.
Well, you could do, and to be honest, that's far more entertaining than the entire episode, but
So you start with they're charting a vast globular cluster.
Yes, a globular cluster is a very, very bad poo, apparently. Extra paper needed for the globular cluster.
We have Riker in bed in PJs.
Well, they're half decent PJs.
They are. They're all right. They're not as bad as shoulder pads.
Oh yeah, well, he's got to look his best for the women, hasn't he? Even in his PJs.
Right. And he's late to a briefing because he's overslept again.
That's probably why, actually, thinking about it, why he does that funny shoulder thing he does, where one shoulder's always one higher than the other. Clearly one shoulder pad is heavier than the other, even in his PJs.
Oh, okay.
That's why he goes through doors sideways as well. The shoulder pad is too big.
Okay, so what has he got in his trousers that's making him sit like that?
Let's not dwell on that. Animal, vegetable, mineral.
Riker rocks for balls. Yeah, anyway, we know that Riker isn't too good because his hair's all mussed. Oh, poor Riker.
Yeah.
Anyway, he gives permission for Geordi and Data to modify the sensors to increase efficiency so that their being in the globular turd takes less time. It's a shame they can't do something similar to this episode.
Skip to the end.
Then you have Data's poetry reading.
Yeah. Yeah. There are people out there that like Data's poetry.
My mum is one of them.
Well, okay. I can't really comment because I'm tone deaf when it comes to poetry. It does nothing for me at all. But it's just the fact that it's all done in the same monotone delivery.
Yeah. Everybody's all sleepy and fidgety, and he starts with Ode to Spot. And because Riker's actually fallen asleep and Troy nudges him, he starts clapping before the end.
We get Troy's new hairdo, which is very poodle-like.
It's just wrong.
It's not a great look, I grant you. No.
Yeah, my notes just say, they need telly. It's like the 19th century or something with fucking harpsichords. Because that's what they should be doing. Or yeah, they should be in a proper, like, where you have poetry readings is in, like, the upstairs room of a pub or something. And they should be drinking beer. And then it wouldn't matter if the poetry's bad, because you've got beer.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not sure if this was being held in tenfold or not. I can't remember now, but...
Even if it was, they don't have any proper fucking beer, do they?
No, they don't. And
it's all pissing sinful.
As you proved.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not good. The only interesting bit is the fact that we see Picard's got an unusual date for the evening, by the looks of it. We've got Ensign Jay, who sat really close to him in civvies. The fact that she's sitting as close as she is to him and they sort of make eye contact from time to time does make it very much like she's his date for the evening. Very curious.
Yeah.
Ode to Spot will return in a fistful of Data's, by the way, as if you hadn't got enough of it
Woo
already.
Woo and indeed who.
But I do remember that episode being rather more entertaining, so I'm looking forward to that one.
Okay. Anyway, this poetry reading bollocks is like, that's the end of the teaser.
Yeah, that's the jeopardy, having
and
to cope with.
It's like a teaser supposed to make you want to watch more, and at this point I wanted to do almost anything else.
Yeah. I mean, by 6 years, you just thought they'd got a hang of teasers by now.
Yeah.
I mean, when you've had terrific teasers like blowing the Enterprise up,
yeah.
And, you know, well, admittedly you can't do that every week, clearly, but nevertheless, this is just a new low when it comes to dull teasers.
Terrible. Then you get Riker in sick bay, which I mean, at least it's sensible that that's where he's gone. He's suffering from a lack of REM. Shiny, happy people holding. Shiny, happy people holding. Shiny, happy people laughing. Sorry, lack of REM sleep.
He's not a shiny, happy person.
No. And Beverly recommends a posset. Well, not actually a posset, it's a hot toddy, but...
Yes.
My brain immediately went to the Box of Delights and a posset place.
If you've not seen Box of Delights, it's a wonderful, glorious 1980s children's BBC programme, which is an adaptation of a John Masefield book. It's absolutely beautiful. Well worth checking out if you can get hold of it. And yes, there's like 10 minutes of an episode is made of them making this medicinal posset thing with egg and stuff. You'd think it'd be really boring, but it's just complete charm on the screen. It's
yeah, lovely. Well, and the music helps.
Yeah.
And then you have a nice shot of Geordi at an engineering console with the lights of the warp core reflected in the shot. I guess I was looking for things I liked in this episode.
Mm-hmm.
But that was one of them. And then Data asks Geordi about his poetry, and Geordi says his poetry is clever, but didn't invoke an emotional response. Well, he won't invoke one in me. I wanted to smash things. But I don't think that was the response he was looking for.
No.
And then there's a power grid alarm, and there's an explosion in Cargo Bay 4. Clean up in aisle 4. No, sorry. except there isn't. There's just, like, three confused-looking blokes.
Yeah, so this alarm goes off, and everybody strolls to Cargo Bay 4 rather than rushing. It's bizarre. They just wander down the corridor as if, I don't know, I was going to say somebody left the window open, but clearly that would be an urgent matter as well.
Yeah. In a spaceship.
Yeah, no, this is perhaps somebody was suffering from, I don't know, emergency piles or something, you know, something that wouldn't be particularly urgent.
Toilet couldn't flush. No, slowly going down with a plunger. Oh, no, that just sounds wrong. Slowly going down with a plunger. Smartwatch. But yeah, they're really slow, and they spend ages sort of having a conversation outside the door before they go in as well. And they don't even, like, go, hello, is there anyone there? Or try and use the communicators to sort of say, are you all right in there? Even from when the alarm went off on that, is it a console you call it? Because they looked in the thing in the side of the wall. Is that a console?
Yeah, that's their big status screen thing in engineering that shows the whole ship.
Can they use that to communicate with people?
Well, yeah, I'm sure they can just do the tippy tap and get in touch with them and say, hello, are you all right? Instead of just sauntering down the corridor, opening the door and being all surprised when everybody's fine.
Yeah.
Odd.
Yeah, it turns out it was a sensor glitch. And then you have Riker asking Geordi to be his alarm. And then you have Riker getting his hot toddy, following on to Del's recipe. And then basically you see him go to bed, and then Geordi's waking him up. And he says it seems like he's just gone to bed. But actually, from our point of view of viewers, it also seems like he's just gone to bed.
Yeah, which is relatively well directed and paced, at least. Because you're as surprised as Riker when Geordi says, well, it's the morning. Because you're not expecting that.
No. And then you're in Mott's. Well, it's not Mott's. Mott works for Vajazzle, of course.
Oh, so we have established this, yes.
Yes. So it's Vajazzle's.
This is canon.
Yeah. And Mott's telling Worf he should use conditioner.
Yes. Because he's Worf it. This is our last appearance of Mott, by the way, in the series. Aboo! We like Mott.
Do we see any more of Vajazzle?
There was never a Vajazzle. Just made Vajazzle up.
I did.
That's not even a thing.
Yes, tis now. Tis, because I said so. Anyway, as Mott's cutting Worf's hair, Worf grabs the hand with the scissors and sort of looks sort of both freaked out and confused at the same time, and then gets up and leaves. And then you have Geordi, and his visor cuts out, and he looks all a bit wibbly wobbly. He says it's the second time, so he goes to sick bay. Beverly says there's a bacterial infection, and so when he's going to sick bay, he's asked Data to do some sort of scan for him, and he comes back and went, how did it go? And Data goes, what do you mean? You've been gone for like 1 minute. And it turns out his internal chronometer is out.
He's got a dodgy ticker.
Yeah.
A dicky ticker. Oh no, not a low, a low again. We've got to avoid the low, a low references.
I do.
It is actually striking, though, because you don't expect Data. And Data's even surprised he's in the wrong when it's proved to him that actually, yes, it's he's him at fault. Because obviously, generally, Data isn't wrong about things.
No.
So that's quite cool.
And then you've got on the bridge, they've been asked to realign something somewhere for the sake of stellar cartography.
And now it's time for Who's at the...
Who's at
it's Ensign Rager.
Ah.
So Rael Rager, and I think this is her last appearance as well. I mean, she's been a regular. So we'll say goodbye to Ensign Rager. We will miss you. Bye. So she gets quite a bit to do in this episode, it has to be said. Well, I say a bit to do, a lot of it's actually her being unconscious, but she's in it a lot.
Yeah. So anyway, Riker sort of says, I'll move aside, I'll do it. But then as he touches the edge of the console, he sort of freaks out slightly.
Yeah.
So then he goes and sits back in his chair and says, oh, never mind, back on the original heading. So whatever stellar cartography wanted, they never got it.
No, they were, fuck them. I can't cope with this panel.
Oh, fuck stellar cartography, I'm out of here. Yeah. They find they're detecting a subspace particle emission in Cargo Bay 4. And you can see it in the area.
I hate to go all technical on you, but all hands on deck, swirly thing alert.
Yeah, it is.
It's a very small swirly thing, but nevertheless, swirly thing alert.
Swirly thing alert, yeah. And it's in the area that Geordi was examining earlier, because it was the bit that set off the alarm when there wasn't one. And apparently the metal is in flux. And then got Riker talking to Troy. And she says he's the third person to come to her talking about a strong emotional response provoked by an object. So she initiates group therapy.
Yes, because that's what we want to watch. Group therapy.
Yeah. But it is saved by Riker having the sensible suggestion of using the holodeck to realise...
I think saved is too strong a word. I mean, it's made marginally less dull by using the holodeck like they do. But even so, it's still slow.
No, it is slow.
Slow. Somebody just draw a picture. Oh, yeah. Dear.
And the thing is, as well, as they start with, like, you know, it's a table, it's a wooden table or whatever. And then the computer's remarkably precise the moment anything becomes metal. And it adds all loads of gubbins onto things.
Yeah, no, it doesn't work really, doesn't it?
No. And then you get the clicking sounds, which just sound like dolphins.
That is my one decent impression, a dolphin. Great, isn't it? It's not going to get me on stage, is it?
No, neither's my speak and spell impression.
Doing an impression of a... How old is speak and spell
I know,
now?
I know, exactly. At least dolphins are still around.
Yes.
I think you've trumped me on that front.
Go on, they've got to hear your speak and spell impression now.
I have to take a deep breath for this one. I have to, it involves
drama. Drama.
No, it doesn't involve any drama.
Drum roll.
Bloody hell. I'm not going to be able to do it. I have to be able to hold my breath the entire time.
You'll get the hiccups again if you're not careful.
Yeah, I will.
Do it.
Bring B-R-I-N-G. That is correct.
Yeah, I'd forgotten how freaky that was. Don't do it again. It also doubles as a strangled frog impression as well. That's pretty
strangled
good.
Strangled frog.
Freak out. Freak out.
I now want a band called Strangled Frog.
Strangled Frog. And now that you sit from Strangled Frog, it's Speak and Spell. Somebody make that record now.
The funny thing is, I can't even get it to work with, like, other words, because I can't make the sounds to work with different sounding words.
Well, obviously.
So it would only be ever spell bring. Strangled Frog. That's definitely got to be a band. So you're in sick bay, and there's very small amount of tetrion particles around Geordi's visor, like in the cargo bay. Data comes in, and he says he wasn't on the Enterprise for 90 minutes. He says that the warp core leaves a particular signature, and it's missing for 90 minutes. We must have been somewhere else. This then prompts them saying, you know, were there any other crew currently missing? And they find there were two, which just kind of throws up the idea that shouldn't they, if crew were, like, going away, shouldn't... there be a sensor or somebody told something somewhere at some
yeah
point.
It's a difficult one, that, isn't it, because it's a bit big brother if they're being monitored all the time. But on the other hand, if this is a regular occurrence, and there was at least one other story, wasn't there, we worked out Q-Who, is it, the Borg one where Picard disappears off the Enterprise and they don't realize for ages?
Yeah.
So it has happened before, there is previous, so maybe some sort of alert would be a good idea in future.
So they decide that they need to find the source of the tetrion emissions, and if they do, they'll find what's going on. And then Beverly says that Riker's arm has been amputated and surgically reattached.
Which, again, is kind of freaky. I mean,
yeah. You know,
there's lots of potential freakiness in this story. It's just, it's padded out with terminal dullness.
Yeah. And also, I don't find that particularly freaky. It would be more freaky if he came in and half his arm was hanging off. That would be probably freaky.
Yes, I don't think you'd really see that on tea time television, though. Oh, his arm! Put me off me turkey drummers, that is.
And which one would it be, though? The one with the shoulders up or the one with the shoulders down?
Maybe balance him out, you never
know. That's why they did it.
Yes, they're examining him. Why are his shoulders at a funny angle like this? Hang on, let's take one arm off and see if we can even it. Oh, that worked. Perhaps they did something to his hips as well to stop him sitting that way.
We'll have to watch the next
one. Yeah, if he carries on doing the Riker manoeuvre, we know that it didn't work. My God, Beverly says, they've done something to your pelvis. No, that's just the way I'm sitting.
And then they say that they've got the beginnings of a spatial rupture, Fanar.
I had one of those once. Hospital, yes.
Yeah, well, that's what happens, you see, if you have too many globular clusters.
Clusters, yes, you end up with a spatial rupture.
Oh, that's not right.
And they say it looks like someone's controlling it. And then you see Lieutenant Hagler... and he's just come back. He was one of the missing crew, and he's come back, and he's all sort of grey. And then he sort of collapses, and he's a bit dead.
He's a bit dead?
Yeah.
He did a bit of a die.
He did, yes.
I'm not sure we're told he's dead at this point, but I think you're told by the end that he's passed away. But yes, Crusher comes running up and goes, oh, emergency.
Well, she comes running up and says...
His blood's turned to glue or something.
Yeah, some sort of polymer or something. Mm. But, you know...
He's got prick stick for blood, poor chap.
Oh, dear. That would produce a globular cast.
Well, yeah, hell yeah.
The spatial rupture, they've put it in a containment field, but it's still expanding. And the containment field, at some point, is just going to go. They can't lock onto the bulkheads to beam it out for some technobabble reason. So the only solution is to close the rupture at the source. So they construct a homing device that looks like a chunky calculator.
It's not the best prop ever, no.
And they stick it on Riker because he's convinced he'll be taken because he has been so far using that really, you know, sound scientific...
Well, you know, centre of attention always, so...
Well, I suppose if his shoulders are still wonky, he's fairly reliable that they're going to have another go. Maybe do something with the other arm. Beverly gives Riker a stimulant to keep him conscious to give him an advantage. Riker's in bed and he is a dolphin. And a portal opens and it sucks him in. And then something goes biddly-whip on Worf's console and he notices Riker is taken. And there's Rhaegar and she's on the bed looking very ill, actually.
Yeah, with loads of tubes and stuff in her.
She's looking sort of greyish.
Yeah, it's not good.
But the aliens are fucking shit.
They are rubbish. This is another reason why the story doesn't work, because you've been building up to finding out who these interfering aliens are, and it turns out that they're boggle-eyed Jawas.
I mean, they shuffle, right? Yeah. So running away from them, not hard. They've got claws, so they're not going to be very dexterous.
And their masks are pathetic. They look like they're made out of egg boxes, basically.
Yeah, that's what they look like. Yeah.
There's no moving bits on them at all. Over on Deep Space Nine, you've got all these amazing alien looks at this time. So perhaps they've taken all the good makeup artists. I don't know if this is Michael Westmore as usual or not, but it's just terrible. Absolutely terrible. And that's the main reason why they didn't bother bringing them back, because nobody liked the look.
No.
Just rubbish.
Terrible.
And they called it something monks or something they said they would look like, yeah. The only good bit is when Riker shoots one of them and he does his funny dance.
Yeah, that's funny.
Looks like Zoidberg at that moment.
Yeah, he does. But the thing is as well, what gets me is before he shoots him, Riker spends ages just sitting there, looking around him, looking, and it's just like,
so
get
slow.
Up, you twat.
Clearly you're in danger. Act now, you fool. Don't just sit there. Oh, dear.
You've seen the things shuffle because the robes they're wearing won't let them take a full step. So it's not going to be hard for you to go faster.
So he rescues Rhaegar, goes back through the portal thingy.
And then you have a delightfully entertaining and interesting and important scene to finish with, where they're all in the conference room.
Yeah, and Data suggests that perhaps these aliens haven't got malign intent, that they're just perhaps just explorers, and then Riker points out that they've lost one crew member and they were pretty unpleasant to several others, including himself, so he's not in a happy mood with them, understandably. And there's this sort of vague sense of, oh yes, they'll be back.
Yeah, because there's a sort of fizzy thing that escapes.
But there we are. They're not. What a shame.
No. So, yeah, I haven't had to watch this again, so I'm not as angry as I was.
Yeah, you're just disappointed, aren't you now? Yeah. Your anger is gone and now you're just very disappointed. Next Generation, you can do better.
Yes, can and should.
And what's worse, as you pointed out, Voyager actually did this, because you actually thought this was a Voyager episode initially, didn't you? Because we mentioned it on a previous episode, the concept of it. There is a Voyager episode in season 4 called Scientific Method, where there's cloaked aliens that are experimenting on the crew. And it's a Voyager episode is better than a Next Generation episode. That's a worrying sign, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it is genuinely a good episode, though. I can recommend it, but yeah, that's what I thought I was getting. Something like that, because you then said, oh no, I misremembered. I thought, oh, all right, I've got mixed up.
So, let's have our feedback. And the Mark has this to say. Schisms, or, well, that was creepy. Commander Riker can't seem to get enough sleep at night. The nightmare about Troy and the ensign last week cannot help him. Well, yes, trauma. All joking aside, Schisms is an effective slow burn, escalating dread, and goes full on into a proper horror movie. Leading to one of the best uses of the holodeck, where Riker, Worf and Geordi try to piece together foggy memories of having been somewhere. They remember being constrained in something. They slowly assemble these half-forgotten pieces into a simulated reconstruction until a strange operating table is sitting before them. Very good computer program, that, in being able to make the right thing from their scattered thoughts. It turns out they've all been kidnapped and returned by aliens from another dimension, and like most Trek, it still comes off as spooky even now. as these guys just pop in past shields onto the flagship to have a little play with the crew, and no one is any the wiser. The pacing, mood and acting is spot on, and I'm going to say something. The main character who continually got better performed as the series went on was Riker. Well, he had to opposite Sir Patrick Stewart for 7 years. You've got to up your game a bit. So, yes, as we said.
No, slow, Dread, just slow.
When we went through this the first time, I was like, were they watching the same episode as us? But clearly people are seeing things in this episode that we're not, I'm afraid. But no, we're not going back to watch it again to see them.
No.
And then we've got some MP3 feedback from Puri.
Hello, Orgs. It's the newly rebranded Puri here to talk about Schisms. Well, actually quite an enjoyable episode. It's an interesting mystery, which goes along at a neat pace, but there's a few things that kind of stand out in it. For starters, Data's awful poetry recital. Who's next to Picard? The woman who's sitting next to, is that his date? Has Picard gone on a date with a crewman? Or did she win a competition to, like, have an evening with Picard from the civilians on the Enterprise, representation group? I don't know why that jumped into my head, but it was kind of something I was kind of curious about, just because she was sitting there looking utterly bored, and it looked, honestly, like Picard had known he had to take her somewhere and thought, I know, Data's poetry recital. That'll sure. So we've got dishevelled Riker. I like the fact that if he loses sleep, his hair gets mussed. Doesn't happen to anyone else. No one else did anything like that, but yes, Riker. We also find out another flaw in the Enterprise security. So the ship knows the location of every crew member. It can tell, obviously, even in their pyjamas, it can tell where they are on the ship. That's sensible. It might be a bit creepy to some, but it's a sensible measure on a big ship like that to, say, make sure people aren't going somewhere they're not meant to. I mean, it would be great if the computer could just kind of ping when someone's going somewhere unauthorised and you can get security down there fairly quickly, or, that sort of thing. It's quite a nice idea. Sadly, the computer doesn't tell anyone when someone vanishes from the ship, which you think someone would want to know. Not where at space dock people are walking on and off all the time, there'd probably be a check-in, check-out thing for security, but even if there wasn't, yeah, you know where you are. But no, you're in a big nebula thingy, a globular cluster, I think Picard said in his captain's log, blah blah blah, this isn't anything to do with the plot, I'm just explaining what the ship's doing to chew up some time. And, yeah, in sort of that bit, you'd think there would be kind of a thing that, Picard gets a wee email or something, a pop-up saying, by the way, a few of your crew have just gone missing. You might want to look into that. Similarly, the security on the ship were really lax. They had that thing which was important enough to make a red dot flash in the diagram of the ship. And they're sending medical teams and whatnot. Everyone's walking. You don't think they'd be running or that sort of thing, but those wee things sort of distracted me a little from it. But actually, like I say, overall, you had the mystery of something's up, and sometimes it does get a wee bit creepy. I liked when Data reveals he's lost time. I think that was one of the first kind of, when I first saw it, even then, it was like the, woo, this shit just got real, other people imagine things, but no, Data's imagined, that suddenly someone's messing with Data is an important sort of piece. The sort of alien abduction idea is nice, although I'm not quite sure what the aliens are doing, as far as I can tell, tooling about. Steve, let's replace this guy's blood with Play-Doh. It was that sort of thing. They did seem like they were pranking more than anything. And maybe that was the plot. That was actually something I thought of watching it. They kind of muse, what are they doing here? And I think if this episode had cropped up in maybe season 3... you could have almost started forming a slow burn arc of external forces coming to harass the Federation. You'd have had a conspiracy, that sort of thing. And I think it's actually a bit of a missed opportunity. If you thought they were going somewhere with this, it looks like an arc plot forming. And it's actually quite a shame that, the aliens do turn up in Star Trek Online, if you're wondering about any external fiction. Don't know about any of the other things, but they do turn up there just briefly, doing roughly the same thing of replacing people's blood with polymers and cutting off their arms and whatnot. I did like when they do the sort of visualization exercise in the holodeck, for starters, using the holodeck for that. Good idea. And I did like, Troy's new hair, she's got a new haircut. Bit weird, but I did like how when you actually saw Riker in the subspace pocket thingy, that the table wasn't identical to the one they produced. They'd actually produced two different props, which is is nice. They made something familiar in the holodeck, but it wasn't, oh look, we've created the identical thing. as you had in the alien place. It's, you know, that's just lazy and it seems unrealistic, and that was quite a nice touch. And the aliens did, I still think the hoods were probably hiding shonky makeup, but they looked suitably alien and the clicking was quite sinister. So yeah, overall, it's not a classic. It's not going to be one of the greats, but it's an enjoyable enough episode. It passes the time and... you know, I enjoyed it. You know, I think this is the second or third time I've watched it, and I think it went quite well. So I shall talk to you later about the episode Q-Less. Until then, bye for now.
Bye.
Bye.
Yeah, Star Trek Online is really not being sold to me now, because not only has it got those crappy aliens from Time's Arrow, but apparently now it also has the what I'm now christening the Jeremy Beadle aliens, the pranksters. Yes. They really picked up all the really good properties in the franchise, didn't they? Blimey. Yeah. Yes, you got... poor Ensign Jay has the date from hell. Yes, I've got a date with the captain! Oh, it's... See, date is poetry, really. Second prize was a trip with Captain Picard to clean out the ship's latrines, I suspect. And yeah, there should be some sort of population count, I think, at the back of the bridge. You know, a bit like those American towns that have, you know, sort of Deadwood, population 122, and then there's a bit scribbled out because somebody's just been shot. You could do that sort of thing, a counter, you know. Oh, look, we've lost another one.
Yeah, like they're in Battlestar Galactica.
Yes, exactly, like Battlestar Galactica. Yeah, the beginning of the episode, isn't it? You have a counter up there that's quite effective, isn't it? Thank you, Burry. We'll find out what Drew and Tracy made of this.
Hello. This is our feedback for Star Trek The Next Generation, Schisms. That was great, the teaser trailer, wasn't it, with the ode to Spock.
Well, that was my first actual comment, and I was going to say, you know, that's probably the first time I've heard about ode to Spock.
Yeah.
Loads and loads of times you have gone on about it, but that's the first time I've actually sat and watched the episode that...
it's from.
Yeah. But I actually really liked it. It was very
great,
good.
Yeah.
Very good.
And Riker... it was comedy, he was really good acting, tired. It was a brilliant teaser, wasn't
it? Was
it?
Actually, yes, it was very good, very good.
When they discovered that explosion in Cargo Bay 4, it was really kind of dawdling down the corridor, wasn't it? You would have had to be rushing to it. And also, why didn't they just... well, the first thing you do is communicate. You go, hello, is anyone alive in there still?
Especially, wasn't that the scene where Georgie was like... blah, blah, blah. I want a crew and an emergency team to Cargo Bay 4 immediately.
Team.
And we were laughing because he was like, yeah, he said immediately.
Yeah, it was
but
very
then you're taking your sweet time to get there, love.
Yeah.
Again, my question. Why does Riker need to wear shoulder pads to bed? Who does he think is going to see him?
The blue pyjamas.
Yeah,
with
he
shoulder
slept
pads.
With pretty much every woman that's on the Enterprise, so it's not like he's going to impress anyone. Stop it with the shoulder pads.
This is an episode... and it's one of my favourites, actually. I really like it. I love the bit when they're in the holodeck and they recreate the table and it gets dark and they've got the chattering noises. I think it's just, it's real kind of evoking that Twilight Zone or whatever. It's good. I really like it.
It was, but my issue was, they started off with, oh yes, there was a table. So the computer created a table. What they ended up with was not a table. It was like a torture instrument.
Yeah, but I guess it was like a flat surface, like a table, isn't it?
No.
And also, it was like scary when Data had lost the time. You know, he said, yeah, you know, you are correct. I've been in here for whatever it was, 97 minutes, whatever. And then the two members of the crew that were missing. Although, I don't know why the computer wouldn't be constantly monitoring them. And if anyone went missing, you know, like out of an airlock or abducted or whatever, it would immediately say... oh, crew member so-and-so missing.
Exactly. You know, Riker was taken through a portal through his bedroom window. Or, bedroom wall. Why is the computer not going, there is an alien doodah thing on the Enterprise. It's abducting your crew. Picard, you need to be aware of this.
Yeah, you would have thought that the internal scanners would constantly be detecting stuff. It really mustn't be hard to write some kind of computer subroutine to monitor stuff like this. You don't really need someone to say, oh, can you check if anyone from the crew's missing?
Exactly. It shouldn't be a question that's asked. It should be bringing it to their attention.
It's very talky techno babble in the middle. There's going about graviton pulses and a tetrion subspace domain, subharmonics. This is really techy, this. And I know, you know, as myself, I really like all that kind of stuff, but I did think in the middle of it, I could a little bit see your eyes glazing over.
I was going to say, I must have tuned out at that point, because I don't know what the hell you're talking about.
It was really, like, getting science-y. But it's good. I really enjoyed this episode. I don't think, don't get me wrong, I don't think it's for everyone. There's other people that might not like it, possibly like yourself. But for me, this is one of my favourite episodes of all time.
A little bit poltergeisty for me. I expected a little munchkin to come out going, Caroline! Caroline!
You did keep saying Caroline. Especially when Riker went through the wall.
You know, but it was a little bit poltergeisty. But a good episode. I quite enjoyed that. Enjoyed it. Not bad. Thank you. Bye!
Bye.
Bye.
Yes, Drew clearly knows us well by now.
Yes.
It's not our sort of episode at all. Far too much techno babble, yes.
Yeah.
Alien doodah thing alert.
Yeah,
there definitely
like has to
be an alien doodah thing alert.
Yeah.
And yeah, Riker has to be ready 100% of the time for action, especially when he's in his PJs, let's face it. So, and yeah, Ode to Spot has fans, clearly. Just not us.
No.
And the whole thing, the whole tired acting thing just reminded me too much of Night Terrors, which was another dull episode because everybody looks tired.
In the dark.
Yeah, it's just not enjoyable watching if everybody looks like they're half asleep. Sorry.
No, it just makes me want to go to sleep.
And why couldn't they just be, I mean, they made the point that, you know, they don't exactly hurry down to the cargo bay. But why didn't they just beam to outside the cargo bay? That would have got them there quicker and all at the ready. I mean, obviously not going to beam in, because you don't know what the state of play is.
Oh, sorry, I was going to say, beams were outside. I had visions of them beaming people to, like, the space outside and then dying.
No, not looking in through the window. No, that wasn't what I was suggesting. That's clearly not a solution.
No, it's not. That's why I looked all a bit
confused. Can't say the window's fogged up. Oh, I got a car breathe. Yeah, you could tell we're not sciencey people, can't you? Imagine Trek written by us. Oh, my life.
We do better than that episode.
I would like to think we could, but there we go. And we've got some feedback from Dimbo Sama. Yay!
Hello, Dimbo Sama!
Hello, orgs. It's Dimbo Sama here, feeding back on TNG's Schisms. Yeah, it was pretty good. It's a very interesting idea. Well, actually, it's not a very interesting idea. It's aliens experimenting on the crew. It's where silence has lease, except without a big funky gas face. So, I don't know. I don't have a problem where I don't have a problem with shows doing something new if they do, or doing something old if they do it in an interesting way. This is definitely an example of that. But you get kind of hard up if you're treading old ground that the actual show itself that you're making is already treaded. But it was very well implemented. It was really well done. The reveal of everything, the way they slowly reveal that something's going wrong, and, you know, the build up to that, the clues, the holodeck scene with random woman I don't remember was on the ship for. It was really great, and so much better than just showing us the aliens taking them in the first place. The actual reveal of the aliens was kind of a letdown, because the aliens looked absolutely fucking ridiculous, but it was really good, really well done. The whole the laughs reality thing, it's like the only thing Brannon Braga does well, and he does it really well in this, even though I know he didn't come up with the story, but no, his script was really good. I also quite like the bullion trying to overcompensate from very obviously telling a racist Klingon joke before Worf walked into the barbers. Just shouted at the screen, that's what you get for telling racially inoffensive jokes about Klingons after Worf stormed out of there. It was great. I love Ode to Spot. Oh my god, I completely forgot Ode to Spot was in this episode. It was fantastic. I love it. It's just great. Just lots of great stuff. I feel really bad for the ensign who dies, though, of course. Poor guy didn't have a chance. He was a no-name, and his entire pajamas were red. Sometimes fate just deals you a bad hand, man. But no, it was really good. I'm not a fan of Riker. Truth be told, it needs to be said. So I'm not a big fan of Riker-centric episodes, and this was a pretty Riker-centric episode, but, you know, I didn't hate him in this. Riker has his moments. So, yeah, it was pretty good, and don't think I have any much else to say to that. I'll chat to you later about the next DS9 episode, which I forget which one it is. So that'll be fun. Okay, bye.
Ah, oh, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, when you're drawing parallels between a story and Where Silence Has Least, which has got to be Season 2's second worst episode, only beaten by that episode which shan't be named.
So hang on, which one is Where Silence?
It's the one with Nagilum, the floaty face in space.
Oh.
Who starts, he turns that guy into ice or something, doesn't he? The guy who's on the con.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was shit.
No, it was. It's just, you know me, I'm really bad with episode names. But Nagilum, I remember.
So, yeah, if you're comparing it with this, then it's a bad sign, isn't it?
Yeah. Another fan of Ode to Spot.
I know, yes, it has a lot of fans, that one.
Sorry, I'm not one. I love the way you started with, oh, something like, this is a good episode, interesting idea. No, it isn't. Actually, no, not.
Yeah, but... But clearly, it worked for most people. Just,
it did.
Just
it did.
Us.
Just no.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Well, you don't like this one.
I mean, you know.
We're glad you do, but we really, really don't.
Really don't. Had the original podcast survived, you'd have known how much I did.
Yeah. Yes, you get the far more restrained Anne-Marie this evening. I can't decide whether that's a good thing or not, but there we go.
Well, I think it's a shame you don't get the rant, but I think it's good that I'm not rage drinking cider and then effectively being absent for the entire second half of the podcast because I'm sitting in a corner quietly hiccuping.
Yeah. Speaking of which, shall we move on to Q-Less?
Yes.
A crisis in the making.
We'll hit the wormhole in 18 minutes.
Losing atmosphere!
Puts the station on a collision course for disaster.
I just saw Q on the promenade.
Q here? All gone.
Bring them back, Q. Now!
Is Q up to his old tricks?
My advice to you is to evacuate now.
Or is the destiny of Deep Space Nine even out of his control? On the next exciting episode of Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
So again, we have another spoilery trailer, which basically it shows you the alien that the orb transforms into right at the end of the episode, and talks a lot about how, oh, perhaps it's not Q who's behind this. It's like, well, as soon as you start planting that idea in our heads, we kind of realise it isn't.
Yeah, stupid.
Stupid, stupid thing.
Stupid, S-T-U-P-I-D.
Our episode opens with Bashir telling an exciting tale when he took a medical exam to an attractive Bajoran woman with O'Brien. And this is why, oh, it would be a really annoying teeth-grinding scene, except you've got O'Brien in the background doing the most amazing faces.
It's awesome.
At one point, he practically does a spit take with his coffee.
Yes.
It's brilliant. Cole Meany can do face acting so well. We get the Doctor's notorious tale of getting one question wrong, which we'll come back to later in the series.
Yep.
Both the Chief and Bashir are called down to the docking area as Dax and an ensign are trapped in the Ganges. Oh, I was trapped in the Ganges once. Couldn't sit down for a week.
That what happened to Riker?
Yes. The ship has no power and life support is dangerously low. Kick-ass Kira goes for the shoot the doors off option.
The Uzi 9mm.
We love Kira.
Yes.
But Sisko points out the runabout is made of thick duranium alloy and therefore impervious to a hand phaser stroke dog lead. See last episode for details. Strangely, Bashir is picking up three life signs inside and they're unexpecting. Do the Chief transfers some power to get the doors open, and the third passenger turns out to be Vash, whom O'Brien recognises. Apparently Dax found her in the Gamma Quadrant and she's been there for 2 years, having been dropped off by a friend. And they walk past the friend, who is wearing the ship-style uniform, and of course it turns out to be Q. No surprises there.
No.
Bashir examines Vash with added flirting.
Oh.
But she seems to appreciate and reciprocate the flirting, so I suppose that's okay then. Mm. Sisko is bothered by how Vash got into the Gamma Quadrant, understandably. Meanwhile, the archaeologist is dropping off some plundered items at the assay office.
Oh, wow. How exciting is this?
Yeah, the assay office, which will feature in later episodes, believe it or not. It's the station's least exciting room.
Oh, but she does an inventory and it's just like, hooray.
It's not bizarre. It's the locker room. As a surprise, you just didn't need 50p to turn. Oh, they don't have currency in the future, do they?
No, it's effectively a safety deposit box,
yeah,
isn't
it's
it?
As exciting as that. And it's manned by the world's most officious sounding Bajoran as well. Hey ho. Her haul includes something which looks a bit like an Orb of Prophecy. rather confusingly, they've used the same effect, which I think is a bit of a mistake, but never mind. Sisko turns up with the news that the Daystrom Institute is keen to hear of her discoveries. The Institute was name-checked throughout Next Generation is named after Richard Daystrom, who designed the computers aboard the original Enterprise and appears in Season 2's The Ultimate Computer. Vash takes up the offer of passage to Earth, and as they walk past, we see the assay office assistant speaking to Quark ominously for the future of Vash's collection, obviously. O'Brien is inspecting the Ganges, but can find nothing wrong with her to explain the loss of power. He fills Sisko in on events from Captain's Holiday and Cupid. There's a power drain, and Dax picks up a graviton flux that she noticed when they lost power on the Ganges. So, quite early on, we've got a serious sense of threat here, at least. The Chief gives Vash a suspicious look as he drops her off at her quarters.
And the thing about the quarters, right, and I know this isn't overly relevant to the episode, but it's the first time you see it in Deep Space Nine, the drawers make a noise. A bit like the doors. And it's like, what is it that in the future human beings are too lazy to pull open a drawer?
No, you've got to press a button so it goes... Psh.
Yeah.
It reminds me of the thrill you got when CD players first came out and you got the open door button. Because before that, it was like cassette players were all mechanical, and records, obviously, you had to put on yourself. If you don't know about records, kids, Google it. But CDs, you pressed a button and it was a smooth movement as the door opened. You kept pressing the button in and out.
Did you?
Yeah, I did when I first had the CD players. Ooh, look at this. But yes, in the future, they have drawers that do this.
Yeah, because it's, you know, so hard so important. To just open a drawer. And it's like, because also as well, made me think as well, when the power goes, does that mean nobody can open their drawers and get their pants?
Yes! Oh, I've spent 2 months in these pair of pants because the power's gone and I can't open the drawers.
Yeah.
Mind you, aboard the Enterprise in Star Trek V, the toilet works the same way as well. You press a button, it comes out the wall. So imagine there's a power cut then. You can't go for a pee.
And Deep Space Nine, at least you could use Odo's bucket.
I wouldn't suggest that. Anyway, Q appears and they have one of those entertaining bickering sessions Vash used to share with Picard. And this is why I can't stand Vash as a character. She's so annoyingly argumentative. Drives me mad, but never mind. Q clearly thinks they're still an item, but she's not interested. Quark turns up, but Q immediately spirits the disgusting troll away. Yeah. Shades of Loaxana Troy there, we're using that phrase. Yeah. It was quite a nice moment. Vash insists he brings Quark back and the Ferengi offers to auction her findings. She gives him some of the best umoks he's had in a long while.
So why isn't he tenting?
Yes, well, it wouldn't make for very pleasant viewing, would it? But...
Which is they happen to have a shot that passes over his crotch area and it's still quite flat. And if umaks are doing what umaks are supposed to do, he shouldn't be.
Basically, any scene that the Quark is in this episode is worth watching. He's brilliant. Vash's skills bring the Ferengi to reduce himself down to a 22% commission. And the next visitor is Bashir, who's on the prowl and is offering dinner with all the cheese you could possibly want in terms of lines. She finally gets Q to leave, telling him she can cope on her own, which is a thing that will reoccur throughout the episode. But, yeah, not that interesting. Q turns up at Bashir's table, dressed and looking like a Bajoran waiter, and very odd he looks too.
He looks wrong.
It doesn't
somehow help
that it's a kind of a onesie outfit, but, yeah. But he should be used to that from the Enterprise, shouldn't he? He tells the Doctor he's making a mistake with Vash, for which he gets called impertinent in a very Bertie Wooster fashion.
Yes.
Suddenly Bashir turns into Bertie Wooster, it's funny. Q tells him he's looking tired and Bashir heads off to bed yawning. And that's him pretty much written out for the rest of the episode, no? O'Brien spots Q at it and exclaims, "Bloody hell!" Before heading to Sisko to warn him. He's like, "Yes!"
Yeah.
Swearing, excellent.
They have swearing and they have beer. Deep Space Nine is already an improvement.
It's winning, yes. It's winning at Trek. There's another power failure and the Chief puts the blame on Q, logically enough. And if you hadn't seen the trailer beforehand, that's what you'd think it would be.
Yeah.
Sisko goes to see Vash to ask about Q, who it turns out is seated in the background, and responds with an insult. Q compliments Sisko's tailor before changing to the overall style uniform. The commander is unimpressed and tells Q to stop playing around with the station's power. But the omnipotent being claims innocence and reflects with disappointment the commander hasn't got Picard's witty turn of phrase. There's a good sort of underlining of different stuff going on here. And of course, it descends into that famous scene we'd remembered with the fist fight, which is definitely the highlight of the episode.
Shall we settle this mano a mano?
Marcus of Queensberry rules!
What?
fisticuffs, pugilism, the manly art of self-defense. Come on! Isn't this all wonderfully barbaric? Come on, take a poke at me. I know that's what you really want to do. Come on!
I'll wager 5 bars of latinum on Cisco.
You're on.
Fight back! This is supposed to be brutal.
You can pay me out of your profits from the auction.
You hit me. Picard never hit me. I'm not Picard.
Because, I mean, Cisco does to Q what you want to do as Q.
Yeah. Paramaline on Tumblr pointed out that Q has multiple visits to the Enterprise and Voyager. He visits Deep Space Nine once, gets his lights punched out by Cisco and generally treated like a piece of poop and never comes back.
Yes.
That's the way to deal with Q.
Yes.
The music for the boxing scene is great. Wonderful comic turn to that. And obviously the makeup's quite fun as well on Q. Delancey's clearly having a lot of fun.
Yes.
And obviously Cisco's punching Q was a deliberate move to distance him from Picard's character. There's another power cut, this time accompanied by a loss of atmosphere due to hole fractures. And that's quite a nice, scary effect, yeah. Actually, is because they've obviously got big fans and stuff to make it look like all the atmosphere is being sucked out.
Reminded me of Total Recall.
Yes, actually, all that Quaid. Yes, we don't get any eyeballs bulging out, but yes.
And I'm not aware that any of Quark's employees have 3 boobies either.
Oh, I'm sure it's only a matter of time. And you see the holes in the hull that have caused this as well, which is covered by force fields, which is a cool effect as well. Apparently it's caused by a focused graviton pulse, and Cisco fears things could get catastrophic. He also isn't convinced Q is behind the problem. He says it's not his style. Odo has called in Quark over his auction. His select clientele is ridiculously wealthy and not too bright, according to Quark.
I love that.
Which is nice.
Unfortunately, it describes our government.
You were quite. Odo doesn't understand collecting things. Quark tempts him briefly with the idea of a latinum-placed bucket to sleep in.
And I love the look on Odo's face. He does consider it, and then he's like, no.
Q shows Vash the effect of an insect bite that she'd had if he hadn't been with her to save her, which is pretty grisly. And it involved a lot of lengthy makeup jobs, apparently, but it looks effective.
Mm.
Dax has come up with a way of tracking the power drain, and Q turns up to mock them.
Still chasing your own tail? Picard and his lackeys would have solved all this techno-babble hours ago. No wonder you're not commanding a starship.
Security to ops.
Well, aren't we the feisty little go-getter? I'd keep my eye on this one. Chances are she's after your job.
Why don't you do something constructive for a change? Like torment Cardassians?
Do I know you?
O'Brien, from the Enterprise.
Enterprise. Oh, yes. Weren't you one of the little people?
And, indeed, he mocks Next Generation as well with his mention of technobabble.
Yes, I like
particularly
that.
After all the technobabble and schisms, we're all with Q at this point.
Yeah.
It was a deliberate dig that Iris Stephen Bear put in the dialogue for having a go at the overuse of technobabble in Trek. Q basically, it's great, has some mini interactions with all the crew at this point, which is a shame there's not a bit more of this in the episode generally. He notes Kira's angry tendencies.
Yeah.
He has a huge put-down line for O'Brien.
One of the little people.
Ouch. And he calls Cisco Benji as well, which again...
Benji's Zax and the Alien Prince.
No wonder he didn't come back on the station. I think he'd be allowed back on having called Cisco Benji. And he tells the gang, as he puts it, that Vash is more dangerous to them than he is. Things have gotten so bad, the station has been pulled out of its normal position towards the wormhole, which could rip it apart.
I'm afraid I had a vision of Deep Space Nine kind of going down a plug hole.
Oh dear. Meanwhile, despite all the chaos that's going on, the auction is still carrying on as ever. There's a nice design for Quark's customers. We have what I'm calling Facehugger Face,
yeah.
Who's Colos. We have the Clothheads, including the wonderfully named Rul The Obscure.
I love that.
Which is one of the best Trek names ever.
Yeah.
Such a Douglas Adams about that, isn't it?
Yes.
That's
the first track, by the way, on Strangled Frog's album.
Is it? Rul The Obscure?
Yeah.
Is that making it sound like a prog rock album now, I'm afraid?
Yeah. Yeah, the track goes on for 12 minutes.
Yeah. So we get the twin Ferengis of Bling, wearing all the shiny stuff, and a character that I can only call Beaky Green, some sort of weird bird creature thing. But great effects, all of them very different.
Yeah, and you contrast that and big are their parts, not very...
Yeah, I know. I mean, they're only on the screen for seconds, but they're miles, miles better than the Jeremy Beadle aliens.
Yeah.
Q interrupts them to tell them the bad news of what's going on outside. Vash calls him evil to kill everyone, but Q is again not taking the rap, but offers to help. Dax traces the power drain to the promenade. They beam the orb lookalike off the station and it turns into the space squid. We've been here before, haven't we? But thankfully that isn't the focus of the episode. Quark tries to tempt Vash with more archaeological shenanigans, which he can then sell later on. Q agrees that that would be more interesting for her than going to the Daystrom Institute. He says he's going to miss her, which rather undermines Q somewhat, and a omnipotent being is going to miss that annoying argumentative archaeologist. Bashir strolls in, having slept for half the episode.
He's like, what did I miss?
Yes. Originally, it was only going to be Vash in this story, which would have been far worse, I guess, because the Q bits are the only good bits, I think. It's Q's only Deep Space Nine appearance. It's Vash's last appearance. And Ira Bear stated that they were included in a story to show continuity with Next Generation Universe. But by season two, they no longer felt the need for that sort of thing, which is fine. You know.
See, I disagree about Vash because in Next Gen, you don't understand really why she's with Picard. You can understand why he had a one night stand with her, but the idea that she comes back doesn't work.
You
for
can
me.
Understand why she's with Q.
Yes.
Because the opportunities that she gives her. And at the end of Cupid, when she goes off him, that does make sense.
It makes sense.
About the only thing in that entire episode that made
exactly. sense. Exactly. It also makes sense that, and I like the interaction between Vash and Quark.
Yes, Vash and Quark are a great
couple. Vash and Quark work.
Yeah.
But it doesn't work that Q...
is chasing after
chasing
her.
Chasing after her,
no. needs her for some reason.
No,
like,
it doesn't.
Why does he need her, of all people?
Well, I'm guessing he needs her because she stands up to him.
I don't know.
I don't. But yeah, that's the aspect that doesn't work.
Yeah.
I think that what the idea that they have been touring the Gamma Quadrant works. The idea of Vash and Quark definitely works, and I enjoy that. And I like her interactions with Quark, whereas you don't like her as a character.
Mm.
I do in the scenes with Quark. I think that's a good pairing.
Yes, it is. But and a lot of that for me is just the entertainment I get from Quark, basically.
Whereas actually, for me, it's both, actually.
Yeah.
I like both of them in those scenes. That's a good interplay.
Yeah. Delancey himself was disappointed with how Q is presented in this episode, as he put it, a skirt chaser. Nice
Which,
word.
I mean, don't like the phrase. Yeah. But you can understand why he was disappointed.
Yes, again, it's an omnipotent being chasing after this strange woman. Doesn't make any sense, really, does it? And as with most Q stories, the title makes no sense as well.
No.
At no point are they Q-less, other than from now on, after the episode inwards, basically. I mean, it's not bad. There are plenty of entertaining scenes in it. It's certainly not as bad as Schisms, but it's probably the weakest episode of Deep Space Nine we've had so far. But having said that, it's not bad. It's certainly not Season 1 Next Generation bad, so...
It's a sort of 3 out of 5 job.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because bad would have to be 2 out of 5. It'd have to be less than half.
Yep.
But I would say that most of them thus far have been 4 out of 5.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is a drop in quality.
It
but
is,
it's
yes.
not yet...
It's not a drastic drop, though.
But it's not yet bad. Okay.
So we've heard from Sampo.
And Sampo writes, feedback on Q-less. A very meh episode. Worst of the season so far. I wouldn't say it's very meh, but I agree it's the worst of the season so far. I really don't care about Vash. Oh, you're with him then. Q episodes are usually hit and miss, but this one did not annoy or entertain. I found it a bit odd how interested Q was in Vash, but on the other hand, it at least gave a credible reason for Q being on the station. Instead of just going, hey, a new show, must go and annoy the cast, Q wasn't actually even interested in the DS9 crew. And that is good, not just directly copying the episode format from TNG. I did enjoy Sisko punching Q, although maybe it was trying too hard to underline the difference between Sisko and Picard. Am I the only one who finds the whole Ferengi ear stroking a bit uncomfortable? No, you're not. Let's say that Quark was a human. Vash would basically have been giving him a hand job during the negotiations.
An ear job. Thankfully, they never use that phrase.
No. I really thought that the thing Vash was selling was an orb of the prophets. Me too! Until it changed into a giant manta ray thing. Goes to show that I had no memories whatsoever of this episode. And I really don't have anything else to say about the episode. First episode of the season that I did not enjoy. But at least I'll get a broadcast episode about it.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, eventually.
yes. Damn near didn't, but yes, you have eventually, hopefully. Providing this hasn't screwed up. Yeah, I mean, the business about Umarks and stuff, I mean, again, it's you can get away with stuff when they're aliens that you can't get away with human beings, clearly. But, yes, effectively,
yeah,
it's glad we didn't watch that one with our daughter. We might have had to explain what was going on at that point, mightn't we? But I just love Schimmerman's acting. That's what makes you... He just throws himself into it, doesn't he?
He does.
The way he's clearly just being swayed from his usual... mercenary ways by her attentions is just brilliant.
Yes.
Cool. Then we have some feedback from the mark. Q-less, or Picard and his lackeys would have solved all this techno babble hours ago. Vash and Q are back. Yay! But they just don't work in Deep Space Nine. Q more than Vash, as Vash and Quark make an interesting double act scheming away with and against each other.
Yeah.
Yeah. The danger from the artifacts is uninspired and looks like a lamp my folks had when I was a kid. Weird. I think they can get away with this sort of thing once, basically. There's a limited number of times that the station's going to get sucked into the wormhole before it gets... I mean, it's an obvious threat, but you can't do it that
too. It's like Voyager nearly getting home.
Yeah.
They could have done it a couple of times, it would have been all right. But then after a while, it was just like, no, you're not getting home. I don't need to watch this episode.
Last time we talked about relics and the difference between the original series and Next Generation. This time we get the difference between Deep Space Nine and Next Generation. And the fact is, Q, godlike alien, does not work on the frontier edge settlement setting of Deep Space Nine. The plus of this story is showing the difference between Sisko and Picard in how they handle the annoying, sufficiently advanced aliens. And the first moment of the utter badass that Ben Sisko will grow into. Picard never hit me, I'm not Picard. Q's sharp lines poking fun at the Deep Space Nine crew are amusing, but the fact is the magic wish-granting alien has little place in a setting in a world with refugee camps, comfort women, food shortages, and planet-wide strip mining, and a station where half of everything does not work. It's out of place in the tone, and the only time Q worked in a darker setting was Q Who, the one with the Borg. That is the one story I hate having missed out on. And it's slow, so slow. Interesting. We didn't find it particularly slow, did we?
No.
I mean, I do agree that Q doesn't quite fit into this universe.
I agree with that.
Yeah. I believe this marks the only appearance of the term technobabble in Star Trek dialogue.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me.
However, it feels to me that Vash shouldn't be interesting enough to hold Q's attention for more than a few hours or days at most.
Yeah.
Not the year plus that they've been wandering. Quite agree.
Yeah.
Even with these quibbles, it's likable enough to scrape a pass.
I think that's how we feel, actually. Mm. I mean, we're disagreeing on minor points, but overall, it's like, yeah, it gets a pass. It doesn't get much more than that, but it gets a pass. We're not disagreeing as much with our feedback as over this one.
As we were over Schisms so far. Okay, let's find out what Dimbo-sama makes of Q-less.
Hello again, orgs. Dimbo-sama once more, feeding back on Q-less. Yeah, so here's the first bad episode. Not a big fan, The episode starts with Bashir telling his war stories of playing Risk. Seriously, Rimmer flashbacks, like, oh my god. Now, I know it's was for a different podcast, but could we use Murray the Pie Man's God He's a Dick for early seasons Bashir? Because I cannot stand early seasons Bashir. But yeah, I just think it's a really dumb episode. It's basically a crossover episode with TNG, but without any of the TNG. We've already had TNG and Emissary, so we don't really need that kind of, oh, come over to this side and have a look at this kind of thing. But they decide to do this kind of episode anyway, which is like that, but instead of actually having TNG characters, you have Q and Vash. Now, Q's kind of obvious because Q's a fan favourite. But I don't know anybody who's particularly too fond of Vash. He's not a terrible character. It turns Q from the good Q, the knows more about humanity than humanity knows about itself, looking to teach Picard through example and through experience Q, as opposed to what we have in this episode, which is skirt chasing Q. He's very, very, very creepy in this episode, and I'm not a fan of it at all, and usually I love Q. So you have a character who is very popular but is being portrayed in a really creepy and not fun light. And then you have a character who's only been in two episodes of TNG in the first place and was basically there just to serve as a love interest for Picard. And these two characters come in and basically it's their episode. It's like an episode from a show about a couple that we've never watched before. and it completely sidelines everyone except maybe Quark. And that's not a good thing. Like, it's still, you bring in any characters you want. Loads of shows do it. Loads of shows do it really well. But it should still be a Deep Space Nine episode. It should still be about our characters. And it just, it doesn't work. And there's no mystery. Because it's not Q. It's clearly the thing Vash has brought. And Q flat out tells them that Vash is the one who does it as well. And they still spend another 10 minutes trying to figure out what's going on. And it's so poorly executed. It's not fun at all. I have to say, though, I do like Sisko punching Q in the face was wonderful. And it isn't just because Q is the trickster. It was because Q is insufferable in this episode. Oh my god, when he showed up on the bridge and told them that basically it was Vash who was doing anything, I just want to tell him fuck off. I seriously so fed up with him in this episode. It's just ridiculous. For those who are fans of Q getting kicked and punched in the face, by the way, I have to tell people about the mid to late 90s FMV PC game called Star Trek Borg, where basically you get brought onto a ship fighting the Borg and you have to stop a disaster or whatever. I can't remember exactly, but Q takes you there. Q basically whisks you away in one of his ridiculous things, and he shows up all through it. And there's one point you can kick Q in the balls, and it makes it the very finest video game ever made because of it. So I thought you might enjoy that. One other thing I did like as well was Quark trying to get under Odo's quote-unquote skin. What would you like with a gold-pressed bucket? And Odo considers it for a moment. That was fucking brilliant. But yeah, that's some moments of goodness in a relatively stupid fucking episode. So, yeah, not a fan of that. It's not a terribly awful Star Trek episode, it's just a bad Deep Space Nine episode, and I think that's my problem with it, because so far Deep Space Nine has had such a higher standard than most other Star Trek shows. So yeah, that's my thoughts. Eager to hear what you guys think, and I'm looking forward. Thanks for the podcast. Great all the time. And I'll chat to you next time. Okay, bye.
Bye, cheers, sir. Yes, I think the one episode title they should have used at some point was definitely Cue Balls.
Yes.
and you get the snooker reference as well, so, you know, you're happy. Cue Balls.
Can someone make that a GIF? I mean, I don't know how available that video game is, but, you know, I can't play the video game, but in the same way as I enjoyed the repeatedly punching Byron in the face gif, and repeatedly watching Q being kicked in the balls gif would be rather nice.
Yeah, and speaking of Byron, having just been featuring in the Babylon Project of season 5 of Babylon 5, early seasons Bashir may be a bit of a dick, but he's nowhere near a dick of Byron proportions, let's face it.
No, he isn't, but he is like early Franklin, Mr. Bombastic.
He is slightly, but without actually the idea that he's in any way
succeeding,
yes, proficient
so he's
at being
an inept
a Mr. B-
Franklin.
Yes, he's Franklin without the good lines, basically.
Yeah, or indeed Franklin without the good looks. But then maybe that's just my personal taste. I don't know. Do other people find Bashir attractive?
Yes, lots of people do, especially Garak, apparently, according to Tumblr. But that's another that's another story.
Okay, no, fine. So not my personal taste, but no, that's absolutely fine.
But whilst I don't dislike this episode clearly as much as Dimbo Sama does, I completely agree with him that the main problem here is that it's Q is the centre of attention. It shouldn't be, because it should be a Deep Space Nine thing. And when he appears in Next Gen, it's generally Picard who's the centre of attention.
Yeah.
And Q's enabling, you know, us to learn more about Picard and stuff in the process. So, whereas here, Q just turns up and it's all about him and Vash.
Yeah, and it's not just that, but I mean, of all the characters that get featured, you only really get Bashir, a bit of Sisko and Quark, and bearing in mind how young Deep Space Nine is as a show at this point.
Well, Bashir spends half the episode asleep as well.
But he's in it. Yeah, more than just
about. But Odo's barely in it as well, actually.
Odo's barely in it. Yeah. Kira's barely in it. What does Dax do?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And it's like, for a show that is...
And as he says, Q's quite creepy in this, to be honest.
He
Not
is.
In a good way
no,
creepy either.
No, he is creepy.
Yeah.
You know, I refuse to let you go, so I'm going to abuse you by making you old. Or something.
Persuade you to carry on being my partner by doing
control,
this to you.
Yeah, I'm going
to
try and control you.
No. Lovely.
You know, he is creepy in the
wrong way. So, I do recognise that there are huge problems with this episode, but I think it's just about entertaining enough to get a pass.
And yeah, and for me, it's Vash and Quark, the interaction between the two.
Let's find out what Drew and Tracy think, shall we?
Okay.
Hello, this is our feedback for Q-Less.
Worst episode ever.
I didn't find that too bad, actually. I know we was preparing for a terrible episode. It's not terrible.
It wasn't brilliant. I mean,
It's a bit tedious. Q is just... It can be good, but this isn't a good episode.
No, but this was... You know, Q is such a good character, but the writing on this episode was just an absolute waste for his character. There was nothing of him. You know, I mean, he gets some good storylines in The Next Generation, but Q in Deep Space Nine was just... It was pointless. Absolutely pointless. I mean, unusually for me, I really don't have very much to say about this episode at all, apart from the fact that, you know, I rolled my eyes at least 20 times during this episode, thinking, oh, for goodness sake. And we did laugh a few times, didn't we, about, you know, the cheesiness of it.
We was laughing because of the wrong reasons. We were laughing at the episode.
We was laughing at the episode,
with
not with the episode. And that was bad. I mean, this Bashir making him out to be a little bit of a ladies' man.
Dr. Smooth.
Yeah, Dr. Smooth. What was that all about? I mean, even Miles was like, for goodness sake, this
is
just
always
ridiculous.
Cracking on with the ladies, isn't he?
Yeah, but it was just pointless. Absolutely pointless.
When Q made Bash go old and ill, that was terrible acting on her part,
wasn't
it?
Such rubbish acting.
She looked really bad. Like, oh, I'm old.
Yeah, and, you know, what's all this falling to the floor, you know? Yeah. Get off. We did say that the Q reveal was done way too early because, you know, they introduced him and then you had about 10-15 minutes of the episode where he wasn't in it at all. And I, like yourself, was sitting here wondering, oh, when's Q going to come into it? What's he going to do? Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
What's happening? And it kind of detracted from the episode because I wasn't really watching it because I was thinking about when is Q going to come into this episode?
Yeah, they shouldn't have done that thing where he was the guy looking at the runabout and talking to the runabout. When they were stuck in there and they said, like, oh, quick, we've got to get the door open, why didn't they just beam them out?
Well, yeah, you did say that, but there was no sense to it at all, was it?
No.
To be fair.
But yeah, they shouldn't have done the Q reveal. You probably would have known Vash went off with Q if you know Next Generation, so you'd be waiting for him possibly. But still, if they hadn't had him in at all, they could have halfway through the episode had him come in.
Yeah.
But I guess they were trying to set up the fact of, is it him that's causing all the trouble? Which we both guessed it obviously wasn't, and it was that thing, whatever it was, the crystal thing.
Yeah, I mean, even I've guessed it. I mean, come on.
Yeah. Not very good
story
writing on that, I think. It was obviously not Q and that thing.
Yeah, this was just a really poor episode. I mean, I was starting to look out the window again. It was. It didn't hold your attention. It was just a bit like, yeah, I know what's going to happen.
It's the worst that we've seen so far, but I don't think it's terrible.
Well, it better get better.
So that's about it, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, I've got nothing more to say on that one. Thank you, bye.
Thank you, bye. Thanks, guys. The Q reveal, to be fair, is in the bloody title. So even if they hadn't showed him at the end of the teaser, they, you know, it's a bit of a giveaway as soon as the title of the episode comes up. But they were obviously using Q to sell it and, you know, whether or not it was a good idea, they only did it once, thankfully, so we can move swiftly along. Move along home. Oh, no!
Alamarain, count to four. Alamarain,
count to four. Alamarain, then three more. Alamarain, if you can see. Alamarain, you'll come with me.
Alamarain, you'll come with me.
Yeah, I do think it is. Dr. Bashir is not so smooth.
No.
I mean, he's trying to be smooth, but he is, you know, Mr. My medical exam stories make all the ladies wet isn't really convincing, I don't think. It clearly works on her, but I'm with O'Brien on that, really.
Crying.
Yes. No, I'm definitely with O'Brien on that. What the hell?
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, I can understand people being disappointed with this one, but I do think it has entertaining moments.
See, I do like it overall, but neither you nor I are massive fans of Q.
No.
I think I can understand if somebody is like, Q's one of their favourite characters.
And expecting big things from a Q
episode. Because he is poorly served by this episode, so it's going to make them more angry. And
I think everybody's poorly served by this episode. I mean, that's the ironic
apart from
thing.
Quark?
Possibly apart from Quark, yes, you're right.
But yeah, I mean, if you're a massive Q fan, watching this is just going to make you cross, really.
Yeah. Let's find out what Puri has to say about Q-less.
Hello again, guys. Party here to talk about Q-Less. Now, this episode kind of worked and kind of didn't. It was one of the ones I had in video, and I still quite like it. Does Q work with the Deep Space Nine crew? Arguably no. It's definitely different, and I actually think that works quite well. When we got this sort of thing happening in Voyager, and possible Voyager, but definitely when they brought it back, next-gen staples in Enterprise, when you got like a Borg episode or a Ferengi episode, it really looked like the writers were running out of ideas. At this point, we're still happy enough to think that they are just trying stuff out, but yes, it is sort of, oh, we've brought a next-gen villain, let's see how this works out. And I do like the way he does work differently. Obviously, the most telling moment is when Sisko punches Q in the face. I thought that was quite nice. You're quite good. It does sort of exemplify the difference in the series. You know, yes, Picard would never have punched Q in the face, but oh yes, Sisko will. I also like the way he almost kind of mocks the crew. You know, goes around quickly and, you know, you've got O'Brien was one of the little people. And, you know, so there's some really nice touch. I think the humour works well. John Delancey worked quite well. But I'm glad they kept it to one episode. I think you couldn't have had him come back and do yet more mischief here. I think they got all the jokes and they got sort of the interaction with him and that was it and they left it behind. It's not like Voyager where they kept bringing him back again and again and again. And then Son of Q. Yeah, you're probably quite lucky you ducked out for that one. Right, so the episode itself, we also have Vash return, and I say again, you do have the fears looking at it that they are returning to the next generation well and bringing back characters. Almost the, oh look, I know it's a new series, but look, here's people you know, here's people you recognise. But actually, the episode, you know, the sort of bulk of the episode without Q lurking about in the background is quite interesting. You know, Vash is an artifact that turns out to be a giant space fish, which is punching holes in the hull and dragging the station. The kind of issue is a bit of a kind of MacGuffin just to give the plot somewhere to go, but actually what's probably more watchable is Vash and Quark, who I forgot how well they work together. They do really make a good double act, one playing off the other, and it does actually come across as quite generous. Out of curiosity, I know the rubbing of the ears in the Ferengi is kind of an erotic thing. I'm guessing that kind of works more as if someone was, if you'd like a sensitive back or something, someone's stroking that. It's not actually like when Vash wants something, she's tickling Quark's tentacles. Testicles, right? You know, just, it's one of those things that I do like to try and keep clear in my mind, because otherwise people randomly rubbing Ferengi ears in public sounds really creepy. So yeah, the episode goes along quite well. You know, just a decent pace. It's maybe not a classic, but you do have sort of odd things happening, and there are enough. The other interaction is, it's almost, I'm actually amazed there hasn't been sort of a the wisdom of Odo, him doing his speech on the sort of human predilection for acquiring things, is again pretty well done. And like I say, you've almost got, I think it's more prevalent in the first season, but you do have Odo's philosophy on normal people, because we had his relationship one earlier, and it works quite well. So yeah, and obviously you have the auction and whatnot, but while I think maybe your biggest criticism of this episode is it's incredibly lightweight, we're not moving on any form of arc plot, so to speak. There is something there which could be in Section 31, but I think to reveal it, it doesn't really contribute anything to this feedback at the moment, but remember some of the stuff. Oh, as actually, as another good performance, when Bashir's doing in the intro, Bashir doing the Starfleet medical finals, O'Brien's face is in the background again. A good job of Cole Meany, and I think this is what we're seeing here, is quite a lot of the cast are actually quite good at acting, and they're really beginning to sort of get into the characters. And so, yeah. Overall, and oh yeah, as a final thing, the fact that Starfleet knows about Q, the fact that they've briefed on it, works really well. So yeah, overall, it's definitely not a classic, but actually, it's again a bit like the last episode. It's entertaining enough. You maybe wouldn't put it on your list of all-time favourites, but if it was on, you'd watch it. You wouldn't be hunting for the remote, and you wouldn't be going off making sandwiches, that sort of thing. Just to say, I am enjoying the podcast. Do keep up the good work, and until next time, I'll talk to you later. Bye for now.
Bye. Yes, yeah, it's an interesting one, this Umax business. I've looked on Memory Alpha, and they do say that the ears are a major erogenous zone, so it's a bit more than a back rub, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
But at the same time, it says that Umax isn't strictly sexual, and may be employed for other reasons, notably as a means to an end. And rather worryingly, it's reminded me that in the season 4 episode, I think it is, Little Green Men, Nog gets umarks from a human nurse. He tricks her into it. So, yes, best not sort of pursuing that one down a sexual line too much, is it really? But it's definitely kind of there, isn't it?
It is.
And
it's
certainly,
when
it was introduced in Menage a Troy, I mean, it definitely was a sexual thing, yeah, wasn't it? That Loaxana was giving the Ferengi umarks in order to escape, basically.
Yeah.
Definitely agree with Murray that you wouldn't want Q coming back again. I think this is one visit to the well is quite enough, thank you. So there we go. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Parry.
And thank you to all our contributors.
Thank you.
I think we might have managed it this time.
Let's hope so.
So the next time we'll be recording will be Thursday the 12th of June, and we'll be looking at the Deep Space Nine episode Dax.
Okay.
I wonder who that's about. Apparently she's accused of murder.
I vaguely remember this
one. Literally, all I remember about this one is that she's accused of murder and won't defend herself or some such.
Nah, right. I'm not going to say anything because I don't want to spoil it for you. Although, of course, if you listen to the trailer, it might.
Yes.
But I have more of a memory of this one because this is one of my favourite early episodes of Deep Space Nine.
Oh, cool.
And so it's one I've rewatched quite a lot.
Oh, right. Well, there you go. You get to cover that one.
Cool.
Somehow or other, I've ended up with another Q episode for our Next Generation story. It's True Q.
Oh.
Again, what the hell that's got to do with anything, I don't know. But apparently it's the one with he has a daughter in it or something.
Oh, child actors.
No, I don't think she's that young. She's more sort of teenage. And I think Riker gets involved with her at one point as well. Yeah.
I hope it's not in that way.
Well, we shall see.
No, I have a vague memory of this being not good, I'm afraid.
Mm.
Unless I'm mixing it up with something else, which has happened before, but unless I'm mixing it up with something else, I think that's a big pile of wank.
Well, we shall see. We'll find out. So if you've got any feedback for the episodes we covered this week or the ones we're going to be looking at next time, then do feel free to contact us. All the contact addresses are over the credits at the end of this. I'm just going to put a little plug in for the Black Dog podcast.
Yes.
Which just recorded its 200th episode. So congratulations, guys. They cover movies, basically. I can highly recommend the Black Dog podcast. And that's available on iTunes and on good old Geek Planet Online.
.com,
indeed. Okay, folks. Take care. Cheer bye.
Bye. Manamana. Manamana. The bOrgCast is brought to you by the lovely people at geekplanetonline.com.
Music at the beginning of this podcast was written and performed by Adam Buxton and is used with his kind permission. All music referenced is for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended.
To contact us, you can use the forums at geekplanetonline.com.
Visit our Tumblr site at bOrgCast.tumblr.com, where you'll find images accompanying the episodes discussed in this cast.
Send email messages or MP3s to bOrgCast@geekplanetonline.com.
Or you can contact us via Twitter on rev_org or bOrgCastAmmo. Hashtag bOrgCast. Do